I've been fighting with a sore knee for the last couple of weeks. I can't imagine why, but it might be because I've spent too much time splitting firewood a few weeks ago. So I would offer you, ask your indulgence as I brought a stool so I can sit down during this sermon this morning. Everybody can still see me though, right? All right. Loving God, may the thoughts that you've put on my heart be the right words for these your people. I'm not very good at waiting. Father, time seems to run too slow for me, especially when I'm waiting for what seems like to me a very long time. Sharon and I have a grandfather clock at home that chimes on the quarter hour. A short series of chimes at quarter after the hour, a longer series at half past the hour, and an even longer series at a quarter to the hour, followed by a long chime with a stroke for every hour on the hour. In the morning, when I first wake up, it's often because that clock has chimed at a time probably other than the hour. Those chimes, those short ones, are enough to wake me up, but not enough for me to hear what the clock is trying to tell me. So I don't know what the time is. When I hear part of these short chimes from the grandfather clock, I look across the room, and there, of course, is the digital alarm clock, and it'll tell me exactly what time it is. So if it's a quarter to the hour, I'll lay in bed and wait for the long chimes at the time of the hour to tell me it's okay to get up. But waiting longer than 15 minutes for that top of the hour of time doesn't work well for me. Either I get tired of waiting and get up anyway, or I fall back to sleep because I'm bored with all that waiting. So Advent is the season of waiting. Today we're halfway through the waiting season of Advent. As we look for the promised coming of the Messiah, the Savior of the world. This waiting happens every year. And you might expect that we should be used to it, or at least prepared for it. This year, like every other year, we wait, perhaps impatiently, for that precious gift of God's presence to descend upon us and the rest of humanity. So our Old Testament lesson this morning sounds like a meeting. Oh comfort my people, says your God. That seems like the opening of a committee meeting going on, perhaps, in the kingdom of heaven. I know, meetings are bad news. We don't like to go there anyway. But Isaiah says a committee meeting is going on in God's kingdom. God has the floor. He's pacing back and forth, ready to release the latest and greatest idea for him from his divine office. The whole committee of heavenly beings has been waiting now as they lean in to hear what God expects of them. The archangels stop tapping their pens on the table. The cherubim stop eyeing the bagels on the side, and the seraphim put down their phones and start listening at last, because God is about to speak. About to pass judgment, about to lower the boom sure. See, God has this anointing. Can God be anointed? Of course not. God has this all-knowing habit of saying something completely surprising on a regular basis. Comfort, thunders the voice that made the planets and the galaxies. Oh, comfort my people. Michael and Gabriel exchange furtive glances around the huge conference table, brows knit and eyes narrow among the angelic beings, high and low. Did I hear comfort? Comfort, not judgment, not burn or fry, but comfort? No one questions, however, because God isn't done yet. He's just catching a breath before the words come pouring out like a soaking rain on parched ground. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term and her penalty is paid. After the initial shock, the beings around the table begin to nod along with the echoes of the Lord's proclamation. In the Amen corner pipes up in a voice that says, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. In the wilderness that used to be a lush garden, find an oasis. In a sandy, windswept desert that used to be a marketplace, clear path. But this wilderness, they understand and want us to understand, isn't so that people can get out. It's so that God can get in. Make straight the highway for God. Now, it's not like God's GPS isn't functioning. It's that God needs to know we want him to visit. That consummate gentle presence. God never comes where God isn't welcome. God never opens doors that we barricade. God never climbs the mountains we build to block access to the deepest parts of ourselves. The committee meeting becomes a gospel choir. And as always happens in God's kingdom, worship breaks out. You see, God's people have been waiting in exile in Babylon for a very long time. And God has called together the heavenly council to lay out his plans to bring them back to Jerusalem, to Zion, his holy city. God is ready to take action on behalf of his people, the sheep of his pasture. As the commotion settles down, standing at the door is the woman, whose father, as it says, soon, I'll be there soon. Save some room for me. And the chorus echoes all the way through the years to John the Baptist, sitting in the desert, eating those bugs and honey for breakfast. And his heart starts to bob and his toes start to tap. Amen rumbles from the core of his being as he becomes the voice that repeats the words and prepares the way. But wait. John's message in our gospel text, is it a message of peace, of comfort? Sure, he includes the words about preparing, but he seems to skip the comfort part. John the Baptist is not about comfort is, as, or at least comfort as we imagine it. Comfort as in taking it easy. Comfort as in lying back and letting go. That's not a John the Baptist sort of sermon. He's stirring up, not lying back. He's about working hard and not taking it easy. He's not about soothing troubled waters or about turning things upside down. Beneath the words and the bluster and the creative costumes, John John is confident that the one who is coming is the one who will offer true peace. A peace that transforms, equips, and unites. A just peace that lifts up those who have been pressed down, gathers in those who have been ignored, strengthens those who have been made weak. So you see, John the Baptist called that first century Jewish community to be moved beyond their narrow-minded thinking, out of their comfort zone, the comfort proclaimed by Isaiah and echoed by John in the Gospel of Mark. Is not my or your comfort, but it is our comfort. The comfort proclaimed in Isaiah, we are called to think beyond the I and into the we, and from the me to the us. That's the Advent call, the invitation to invite God to inhabit our world by working together to open those roads and remove those barriers and fill in the pits so that we can see God coming and rush to worship Him together. John doesn't wait. He acts with shouts and cries of proclamation for the same one we wait patiently for in quiet anticipation. One who comes unexpectedly as a child in a manger. But what time? Peter wrote, "Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like a thousand years, and a thousand years is like one day." Because we can't know God's time, we have no choice but to wait patiently. When that grandfather clock strikes those short chimes, we know that the long chimes are still coming, and that the top of the hour is not far away. So we wait a little longer for that precious gift from God that will bring salvation and peace to the world. We wait patiently for God's presence, God's love, God's grace, and God's peace. All gifts offered to us with that small baby in that manger. Amen.